Before you can react, a powerful gravitic force yanks you and your companions into the structure, away from the horrors of Miel Avest. It wrenches the other surviving castoffs inside as well, hurling them to other places beyond your reach, and you suddenly find yourself somewhere else. Well, thank God. I'm pretty happy about that. Somewhere else is a good thing. You are pulled to the feritory, and the world goes dark. Your sense of sight has suddenly failed. You try to move your limbs and find that you cannot. You're alone, cut off from everyone else. You sense the terrifying presence of the sorrow as it surges through the portal behind you. Knowing you are trapped, it reaches out and is hurled back, shrieking in fury. Yay! Its cries vanish at once, as if an impermeable wall has suddenly been raised between you. Oh, thank the universe for that. A terrible new sound fills your ears, a chittering, whispering cacophony. Something probes at the edges of your mind, something vast and incomprehensible. Give in to panic. Yeah, that sounds like a good idea. Resist with all your might. I can only go 60%. You breathe deeply. Success. Channeling your instinctive fear into cold fury, then you focus that fury against the thing that is probing your mind. At once the chittering sound ceases, and you sense the vast presence regarding you more carefully, perhaps even respectfully. Oh yeah, respect is always good. A new sound replaces the chittering, a bone-jarring hum, like the buzzing of insects' wings the size of mountains. It grows stronger and louder. The sound becomes a dull ache that spreads throughout your body. The ache becomes pain, hot and searing. You grind your teeth, straining to concentrate, to keep the intruder out of your mind. Who the hell's in here? This thing's supposed to save us. Then, without warning, it stops. You feel a sudden sense of recognition, and perhaps surprise. The chittering fades, and you slowly wake. Where the hell are we? Ew. Dracogen says, "What is this? What new treasure is here for me to find?" A friendly voice booms. Opening your bleary eyes, you see an earnest, gray-skinned non-human with a toothy smile. He is tall and wide across his shoulders and exudes great strength. His hands terminate in long claws. And he thinks, "That tattoo! So another of the changing god's children has made her way here. It's been a long time." "But where are my manners? My name is Dracogen, and you are in the bloom, though I dare say you didn't expect to arrive here quite like this." My perception tells me that his voice is warm and welcoming, but there's something about his tone that suggests something more predatory. He thinks, "His castoffs always find the most exciting curios for me." Dracogen studies you briefly, his eyes roving across your body with practiced ease. "Do you have questions? Perhaps I can answer them for you." Tybir whispers in your ear, "Don't do it, lass. He's never friendly unless he wants something from you. And you do not want him to want anything from you." "Tybir, old friend!" The tone of his voice is avuncular, his smile wide. "How are you?" He holds up a finger. "Actually, we should wait a moment to catch up. I must first engage your compatriot. I have some pressing business that simply cannot wait. I'm sure you'll understand." He turns back to you. How did I get here? All I did was touch the feritory. You don't remember? A pity. It must have been something to experience. If you'd come down from Memovira's fortress or along one of the roadways, you'd know the path you took. The pathways of the bloom are strange, but not all its roads are pleasant. I felt others pulled into the feritory with me. Where are they? Who knows? The bloom's motivations are inscrutable, and its tendrils pass through countless worlds and dimensions. If you were brought here by the bloom itself, then these others you speak of could literally be anywhere. What were those voices? The bloom is a living creature, with a reach across dimensions. Its consciousness, if I may use that term, is unlike anything we know. So unless I miss my guess, These guys kicking things. What you heard was some of the many voices of the bloom. Huh. Tell me about yourself. He swells with momentary pride. I am Dracogen. I'm the man who can find what you need, even if you don't know you need it. I deal in information, and I pay those who work for me handsomely. Ask anyone here, and they'll tell you I trade fairly. You could also ask your friend Tybir there what happens to those who try to cross me. But I don't think that a relationship starts best with threats. We should work from a common interest. Perhaps you can do something for me. Tybir flinches back and manages a weak smile. Crossing Dracogen, a bad idea, yes. What do you want from me? A business proposition, my friend. I wish to prove my value to you, and then you can provide value in return. I trade in information, favors, and Numenera. And it so happens I know about you and your kind. You're a cast-off of the Changing God, an old acquaintance of mine. Indeed, I have known a number of your brethren. I even known about Miel Avest, your secret refuge. So ask. Ask, and I will do what I can to provide an answer. Tybir groans. Make no deal, lass. Getting crossways with Dracogen is a quick way to an early grave. And it don't matter if you're on the up and up or not. One honest mistake, a simple misunderstanding of the terms of the agreement, and you're vanished. Walk away, girl. Walk away. Now, Tybir, I thought our arrangement worked out nicely. You certainly came out ahead. Miel Avest has been destroyed by the sorrow. Shock flashes across his features, and he wipes it clear quickly. I am truly sorry to hear that. I never had the honor of a visit, though I longed to go. Such accumulated knowledge. So many artifacts lost. The value of the pieces would have been worth... Well, no matter. No matter. What's done is done. He thinks that is valuable information. I need to think on how best to leverage it. I am here looking for the first cast-off. Why not? Take a walk on the wild side. She has been dead for over a century. Have you tried her tomb? She's alive, and she's here in the bloom. Mazov told me. Mazov? How interesting. In any case, you seem to believe what you have said. I concede that common knowledge is not always correct, and I bow to your surety. I do not have your answer, but I know one who might. He thinks, her information is intriguing, but I'm more interested in how she came across it. If you wanted to know anything about the bloom, you should speak to its ruler, the Memovira. Tell me about the Memovira. A hard, ruthless woman. She holds control of the bloom because it favors her. She uses this advantage to dominate the trade routes and control access to the maws that lead to other worlds. But the maws are closing, and thus her funds are dwindling. It would be better for you to find out yourself, my friend. It is an ugly place to bloom, and one should make one's own judgments. All right, where can I find the Memovira? Inside her fortress. But she has locked her gates to outsiders while she considers the problems that face her. Only those who can provide something of value to get to her get in now. He bows. Like me. What do you know about castoffs? I have met your sire. I know that he makes and discards you. I know that the sorrow pursues the changing god and destroys his cast-offs as a consequence. He smiles. I know more, but my trade is information. We'll speak more of what I know later, perhaps. He thinks. I know you are hunted by what might be considered a natural enemy of the bloom. Oh. Is the sorrow a natural enemy of the bloom? Most cast-offs prefer not to come to the bloom. Is a great predator, you know, and something about the psychic energies of your kind seems to have a great appeal to it. Perhaps some residue of your sire's life. You are creations, you are hunted, and nearly all of you suffer. I see. So what do you want in exchange for an introduction to the Memovira? I once had claim to an artifact, but it was spirited away to a place called the Ascension of Kex-Lianesh, a realm of crystalline beauty. I need that artifact back. It's called the Magmatic Annulet, a circlet of dark hyaline material. It is of great interest to me. Great interest. I believe that you may be uniquely suited to retrieve it. He bows. Find it, bring it to me, and I guarantee you an audience with the Memovera. Ascension. How do I get to this ascension? Follow the caravan road to the trade post. You'll find a maw there, and it will take you to the ascension. He thinks, or rather, it did. But that's why I'm sending you, Castoff. Your kind always finds a way toward your sire's footsteps. What's a maw? A maw is one of the many mouths of the bloom, reaching its tendrils through the dimensions. Some enterprising individuals travel these tendrils, exploring new worlds and bringing back strange and wondrous items for trade. What if I decline? He shrugs. You won't get into the Memovera's fortress, and most likely you'll be devoured by the bloom, with nothing left of you but memories of what could have been. But as with all things, this is your choice. He thinks, a stubborn one, this. But give her time. No doubt she'll come back. He gestures toward the large, open chamber behind him. Ask around. You'll find that I trade fairly. You'll also find that I brook no deceit. He stifles a yawn. But I have other business to attend to. If you wish to gain access to the Memovera, you had best go.
I'll remember that.
Remember, the magmatic amulet from the Ascension. He turns to Tybir. And now, old friend, let us resume our acquaintance, shall we? How is Auvigne? Did you have a joyful reunion? Tybir's jaw drops. His face goes pale. I don't... How do you know? His eyes seek yours in mute appeal as his tangled questions take his breath from him and leave him, for once, speechless. Tybir, I guess, thinks Auvigne and Dracogen? How? Oh, gods, the ring! Tybir, who's Auvigne? Former lover. Forget it. Come now, Dracogen says. Don't sell your epic short, Tybir. This was a love for the ages. He claps your companion on the shoulder and turns to you. Let me tell you, the two of them were inseparable. Inseparable. But somehow they parted, lost track of one another. Auvigne came to me a year ago, asking me about Tybir. He came to me, you see, because the two of them shared, let's call them mind-link rings. Well, Tybir gave his ring to me for legal and moral considerations. Shortly afterward, he hoofed it for the city above. Foolishly, I turned the device off as I was examining it, and poor Auvigne thought his lover dead. He came running, begging my help. Well, it seems that Auvigne has broken his word to me. Tisk tisk. And he thinks, I turned it off on purpose. I was curious who would link themselves to him. Auvigne would never do that, Tybir says hotly, then flushes. He's a man of his word, and, well, you have to admit that you do have a fearsome reputation, and Auvigne wouldn't want to cross you. Dracogen taps his chin. This does present a problem, then. Auvigne pledged a year of service to me in exchange for certain information, and, well, now he's vanished. I thought of using the paired mind-link ring you gave me as collateral in order to track him down, but then realized that anything could have befallen the poor man here in the bloom, and besides, who am I to stand between two long-lost lovers? Perhaps you might be more inclined to seek him out than I.
I'll remember that.
So here, you can have your ring back. May it be useful to you. He smiles to you and bows. My apologies, but I simply had to make sure of Tybir and Auvigne. I do look forward to hearing of the successful resolution of our arrangement. He thinks, if he didn't run off, I wonder what happened to him, and whether anybody crossed me. So Tybir's ring. The ring is plain and tarnished. Tybir rubs it with his thumb constantly, spinning it around his finger. Huh. Farewell. Huh. Tybir?
I knew.
You knew? Tybir places a small patch of ground, paces over a small patch of ground as though caged. You call this ground? I knew he was here, and I was looking for me. I should've... He trails off and pulls the ring Dracogen gave him from his pocket. He cradles it in his palm and meets your eyes. Heartbeat. They work by skin contact, see? I'd know if he was... He bites his lip and closes his fingers over the ring. He thinks I couldn't have. I was too scared. Of what he'd think of me, yes, but also of myself. Dracogen had the right of it, he says through his teeth. Auvigne and I were closer than close. The world stomped on us, but we survived it together. Carried each other through wars and harder times. He looks away from you. We were arms of the same body, but with different minds. Too different, as it turns out. He takes a deep, shaking breath. I loved him, he says simply. We have to find him. I have to find him. I don't understand. Can't you use those rings to sense his mind and see where he is? Right, he says with a trembling laugh. You don't know what you're asking. Back in the good old days, it'd be like holding hands, wrapping your fingers around theirs, right? But with their thoughts and feelings instead of flesh and bone. He shakes his head. I'd need to concentrate for one, and two, I'm not welcome there anymore. He made that clear, and I don't know that I disagree. We'll find him. Thank you, he says, nodding. I just want to talk to him. Set a few things right, if that's still possible. He swallows and slips the ring onto his finger. Yeah, closure. What happened between you and Auvigne, anyway? This isn't the time, Tybir says, but he glances up at you regardless. It was mutual, all right? As time wore on, we wanted different things, and I wasn't willing to... He stops himself, sighs. Leave it. Let's just focus on finding him. Not important now. Let's just focus on finding him. Where do you think Auvigne is? He's... He begins touching the ring on his hand and closing his eyes. His brow wrinkles in discomfort, confusion. He's somewhere in little Nyliash. How are you holding up? Same thing he always says. I want to ask you about the bloom. Well, I lived here for a time, though not recently. The bloom is no place for pleasure. He nods at you. Ask your questions and I'll do my best. Tell me what you know about Dracogen. Not enough, he says, looking uncomfortable. He isn't the first man to use that name, and I've heard stories that he can be in more than one place at the same time. He hisses air at the side of his mouth. He pays well, but you don't want to cross him. Ever. You just don't. He's a good businessman, but scary in his own special way. He makes Folsom back in Sagas look like a paragon of forgiveness. What do you know about the Memovira? Not much, and I like it that way, he says, grimacing. Now, if you want to know what happens to people who cross her, just listen for the screaming. Just that people who do business with her meet savage ends. What do you think of the bloom? If I'm being charitable, he looks around, everything's got the right at a chance to live, but this beast hates the people living in it. He shivers. There's a fortune to be made in here if you know what you're doing. He shakes his head. But only the hardest operators last long down here, and the bloom never misses a meal. You'll get along with her just fine if you remember she hates you and wants to bite off every bit of you that sticks out.
Yes, lass.
Tell me about some of the happy times you had with Auvigne. Gladly, he says softly. Truth to tell, it'll be good to get some of the memories off my chest and into the open air. He rubs the back of his neck. I've told you parts and pieces about him. Not sure where to start. Were you and Auvigne together from the first battle you met? Oh no. Our commander separated us after we got out of the brig. He didn't want us planning more herd heists. I didn't see Auvi for a handful of years after that, when we both landed in the only mercenary company that'd have us. He scratches his cheek. You see, even mercenaries have rules. Don't sell the company's weapons on the side, for one. He raises a guilty hand. And don't break your captain's jaw, even if you're Auvi, and he think he's a rock-humping sadist. So we ended up in the Broken Riverbed Company. Thieves, murderers, and drunks with nowhere else to go, but the commander had a good heart. Took the contacts he believed in. Contracts, rather. Believed in redemption. Tybir shakes his head ruefully. Well, he signed us up to guard a village trapped between two enemy fronts. Half of us bolted when they saw the armies coming, and the rest when the bombardment started. I saw a big man pinned beneath some rubble and nearly left him anyway before I saw his face. I think I read this, like, way back when we first met Tybir, but this gives us a good information on Auvigne and Refresher, right? The captain helped me pull Auvigne just before a slug took off the top of his head off. That smile never left his face. I like to think he died thinking he turned one life around before the end. I was even faster in those days, and Auvigne was freakish strong. We fought our way off the battlefield, trench by trench, and kept running after that. He smiles, remembering. It was a week before he realized we were working together in all but name. It's the same thing. Yeah. How did you and Auvigne fall in love? Heh, I think we always were, he says, rubbing his eyes. The two of us were never good at spotting the obvious. He stares at the air. This was just after Auvigne started messing with the link rings and turned a potential battlefield into a muddy pit of romantic acrobatics. Back in the early days, the mind-sharing powers of those rings were... well, they were stronger. And even though we were far from the... fighting, we felt the effects. We stood there watching the magic unfold below and gradually felt each other's thoughts creeping into our heads. He closes his eyes. Finally, he turns to me and says, "You should have sensed something sooner," and he puts his hand in mine. He raises his hand, looking at his fingers. He grabbed the rings after things died down and tinkered with them over the next few months while we moved from company to company and battle to battle. I never asked why. Fixing things was part of what made him, him. Tybir lets his hand fall. Then he gave me one of them. Said he'd be able to keep track of me if we got separated in a scrap, and find me if I was in trouble. He grimaces. That was Auvigne, too. Never thinking things through. How did the link rings change things between you? Well, they made us closer, he says wearily, and at first there was no downside. We were new lovers with a mental link. I don't think I need to draw you a picture. He massages his knuckles. We were tough fighters on our own. With our thoughts linked, well, we were unstoppable, and fools enough to think that the good times would last. Tybir raises his eyes to yours. Because the endless battle was waiting for us. Our orders were to take a hill in the middle of a field of shattered time. He shivers. The first time Auvigne and I fought our way to the top before something snapped in our gut, and we were back at the bottom, 2 hours back. We charged up again, and this time one of those fireballs landed right on us. Tybir studies his bicep. My arm burst apart like rotten fruit, and Auvigne died on the spot. I felt his mind wink out inside me, like someone had crushed him in their fist. He rubs his temple, then snap, back down to the bottom of the hill with Auvigne still alive. But even with him at my side, I couldn't stop mourning him. He swallows. We fought for that damned hill for what felt like lifetimes, dying and dying. Eventually one of our victories stuck, and Auvigne and I got the hell out of there. Looks like they were able to keep reloading. After a moment of silence, he says, Auvigne took that whole mess as a sign that it was time to create our own company, but I was still mourning for him. You and Auvigne created your own mercenary company? That's a generous assessment. I was against the side by side from the first. Thought we were better off on our own. It was one of the first signs that things were souring between us. He covers his eyes with calloused hands. But no, Auvigne wanted to run things, to choose the fights he thought were worth fighting, and he wanted to drag me along with him. Groaning, he lets his hands fall. So he recruited his people, and I stood on the side, hating every second of it. It all went wrong in some no-name village that was burned off the map years ago. He says, looking away from you, he gave me an order I didn't like, so I didn't follow it. And he hit me. He touched the side of his face, said if I wanted to run the side-by-side so bad I could have it, and he walked off. He looks back at you, his eyes soft but hooded. Haven't seen him since, and I've missed him every day, if I'm being honest. What was the order he gave you that you didn't want to follow? Couldn't tell you, he says, turning his head, and it doesn't matter now. He thinks, don't ask me this, I don't want to remember. He shouldn't have hit you. Gold tie, tiny map. Heh, he says, shaking his head. Don't get the wrong idea. He'd never hit me before that. Not once. And our relationship was over long before he threw a punch. You're hiding something, Tybir. What is it? He bows his head. Have mercy, hey? Telling all of this hasn't been easy, and I know I had a part in what went wrong between us. Shaking his head, he says, what does it matter anyway? The full truth isn't going to mend things between Auvi and me. That time is done. I'll get to choose it. Okay. While we're talking to people, Calisthenes. How you holding up? Yes, all repeat questions. Erritis?
Oh, it's you. Can I ask you something?
If you didn't know better, you'd think he looked thoughtful. He rubs the side of his face, then the corners of his sleep-bruised eyes. I've been pondering some things for over an hour about what happened back there in Miel Avest. All those people, with stories so like your own, and now so many of them have just stopped, and I barely knew them at all. How? He pauses, toying with his doublet and staring at the sky, his glow pulses growing brighter and brighter until it's hard to look at him directly. How are they supposed to be part of my story if they're dead? And, whoever thinks, we don't like this thoughts of yous implying him. Yes. Their stories don't matter, only yours. They were my brothers and sisters, and now they're gone. It's not really about you, Erritis. Indigo and silver. It's not? He blinks. I don't understand. Unless I'm supposed to avenge them for my loyal friend. He glances at you sidelong. That's you, of course. There... He begins, then winces. The glow around him is glowing brighter than it ever has before. He doesn't appear to notice, however. Their stories are over now, aren't they? I mean, unless they come back at some dramatic moment, more powerful than they were before. I love doing that. And, he thinks he is still talking. We are filling his eyes and thoughts, and he is still talking. But assuming that doesn't happen, what does it mean? Their stories matter to them, I think. But what do they matter now? The golden light of his aura and his casual words can't quite hide the glimmering beads of sweat rolling down his cheeks. What does one life matter? I like to think that they live on, in our memories, if nowhere else. The stories of theirs that we know are part of something larger now. Indigo and blue. Yes, he says wistfully. A larger story. I've always lived life to the next adventure, but now I'm wondering where it will end. What will it be like? He pauses, shocked by his own thought. What will happen after? He thinks, you will inspire others to follow your example, to host us, to entertain us. Erritis, buddy?
I thought the inside of my mouth was strange for this place. It's like being inside my mouth. Well, it's inside another mouth.
He thinks this place has promised many opportunities for excitement and sacrifice. What's strange about the inside of your mouth? All mouths are strange. Fleshy bits flapping and squishing behind exposed bones. He pauses mid-shudder, thinking, although my mouth doesn't have anyone walking around in it, in comparison to this place, anything's normal. He beams, thank you. My mouth no longer makes me nervous. You seem to be under the impression that this journey of ours is all about you. You say that like it's not, Erritis says, peering at you suspiciously. It isn't. How can you say that? He says, hurt. I'm on a quest to find quests. I thought you knew that. He bites his lip furiously. I'm still looking for the right quest, but I'll know it when I see it. It's the one that will lead me to the destiny that I think I'd see in my dreams if I ever managed to sleep again. Rubbing his eyes with his hands, he says, it's just so exhausting. I want the treasure and the glory and the heroic stuff, but when will I have it? It's never enough. I'm always looking for the next quest. He cradles his head. It's just never enough. Maybe you should be helping people rather than looking for treasure and glory. Indigo tide. I like that, Erritis says quietly, tiny currents rippling through his glow, through him. I like that more than I can say. See if it says anything different here. Oh, alright. This is the muscular orifice that first expelled you into the bloom. It quivers and clenches in agitation. Someone built this simple structure from a motley assortment of planks and timber. The wood is rotting in the damp air of the bloom. This tent is made from scavenged canvas and flimsy wooden poles. It smells faintly of sweat. These shanties are constructed entirely of tanned bloom flesh, with a framework of harvested bone and gristle. Yummy. Memovira's courtyard. Huh. Cool. Oh, Kian, is someone special there? Oh, this is a place we can rest. Hope we have enough money. Anyway, thanks so much for watching, guys. Stay tuned for the next episode when we explore the bloom, or the Memovira's courtyard of the bloom. Thanks so much for watching. See you in the next one, and endure. In enduring, grow strong.